National University, Dr. Vidya, Ervedkar, Pro-Chancellor, Symbiosis International University. Mrs. Shakuntala Gurpur, of course, who hails from my own native place, Sesikala Gurpur. The awardees today who are participating in Guru Vandana program, our great Dr. N.R. Madhav Menonji, Dr. N.N. Mitra, Dr. C.J. Samuel, Dr. Lakshmi Jambolkar, and many others who have been represented here today. Distinguished delegates of the International Association of Law Schools 2017 Global Law Deans Forum and Annual Meeting. My beloved students, all the faculties of law of the Symbiosis University, members of the media, brothers and sisters. It's a privilege, particularly to participate in a conference of the distinguished audience. In fact, this is my, if I remember correctly, third visit to the Symbiosis University. I always pleasure not to reject any invitation. I am eagerly looking forward to visit this great campus. Because of the quality of education, because of the dedicated service rendered by Dr. Majumdar and the family and also the faculty of this university. So today we have just heard Justice Deepak Mishra, the Chief Justice of Supreme Court of India. He enlightened us with a great message today for this global conference. In fact, Oliver Wendell Holmes, he once said, I quote, "The life of the law has not been logic. It has been experience. The law embodies the story of a nation's development through many centuries, and it cannot be dealt with as if it contained only the axioms and corollaries of a book of mathematics." Particularly, our senior advocate Ram Jethal represents this message. And he's just with us. This poignant statement made by Justice Holmes and further quoted by Justice Bhagavati assumes even more significance today. The legal systems of all countries have developed through each other's experience. And you know, we have nurtured it. In the Indian context, recent privacy and Aadhaar judgments in particular symbolized the creative destruction of past approach to fundamental rights. Law is always dynamic. Symbiosis, this great institution, is known for its initiatives at the international front. We are all privileged to know that, you know, more than 85 country students become and take education here. I don't think there's any other institution in the country which represents 85 countries. It's a privilege for us, and we are proud about this institution. Under the leadership of Professor S.P. Majumdar, this institute hosts students, you know, from all across the globe. This is enough proof and reason to realize why Symbiosis was chosen for a conference of such magnitude. involving leaders from some of the best law schools in the world. We have in the dais and in the audience legal luminaries such as Professor Dr. Madhav Menon, Professor Dr. K.L. Mitra, Dr. Lakshmi Chambolkar, and these legal legends have sown and nurtured the seeds of legal education in India and shaped sensation of students, educators, and judges. I recall that, you know, in Karnataka, we wanted to have the National Law School University conceptualized. You know, we gave some money, we gave some land. I think there were 2 days, you know, of grilling. The legislators grilled me, saying that, why should you give that much of money to one school, law school? And, you know, why should you give that much of land to them? I said, on that day, it is still on the record, in the assembly of Karnataka, I said, this is the law university of future. This has really proved. And it is proved. I must say the entire credit should go to Dr. Madhav Menon, who has worked out, chiseled out the concept of legal education. There are, I think today, 20 such law school universities in the country. I think my ambition was that I came out with a paper. Of course, he also is party to, as a law minister, I wanted to have a lot of reforms in legal education. Still, some of them are going on, but we need to do more. Symbiosis International University is also unique in the country. This is one of the few institutions, specifically law schools. Lawyers play an important role in government systems and making remedies accessible to individuals. Be it community legal aid, pro bono legal services, or even the recent episode in the United States when American Civil Liberties Union lawyers came to the aid of hundreds of individuals stranded in airports across the United States when the American president's travel ban came into effect. I have long since advocated that legal education is of utmost importance, which is led by an educationist whose passion is notable and inspiring. Both Professor S.P. Majumdar and Dr. Vidya Erwadkar, along with the Vice Chancellor Dr. Rajini Gupte and also Dr. Sashikala Gurpur, who as Director Symbiosis nurtured this great institution. We are gathered to deliberate upon the synergies between educational institutions in the world. And in fact, it was then, you know, we need to develop this concept in a big way. Not only to nurture more educational institutions, but bring up the quality educational institutions. So, coming to the optimization of synergies and partnerships between legal institutions, it is pivotal to understand that education crosses all barriers and boundaries. I think Symbiosis is the real living example for that. Today we don't view countries as common law or civil law countries. Rather, we are all united by the idea of furtherance of rights and deriving justice. We view legal systems as tools of social change and progress. We aim to solve social, economic and legal problems by utilizing our legal systems judiciary. This is why conferences such as the one we are attending today are quite important. They help us interact with each other and actualize our common but differential goal. We are in an environment where we can absorb and imbibe each other's perspectives and hold a rational dialogue on important issues. Thus, we create a symbiotic relationship and establish ties that bind. The importance of a strong legal infrastructure and sound administration of justice remains a paramount priority for any country. And to ensure some of the role of universities continues to therefore play an undeniable and indelible part in nation building. The lawyers today are not only robe-clad barristers, they are business consultants, advisors and deal makers. They scrutinize the structure of the transaction with their legal lens and devise such strategies which, in the corporate transactions from any potential regulatory bottlenecks. Therefore, sound understanding of business objectives and strategies make their task much easier and more meaningful. Similarly, managers these days do not just require the understanding of financial terminology and sales figures. They need to be aware of all that affects their company's business. There are a plethora of laws: company law, competition law, securities law, financial services law, among others. They cannot be expected, and they will not be able to handle the business affairs without having working knowledge of what the law is. No doubt, we have different set of professionals dealing with these peculiar issues, but working knowledge makes management easier. The need for a lawyer for business arises in respect of deciding on business structure, raising adequate finance from external and internal sources, signing deals, contracts, or leases, as well as the negotiations in respect of the same, developing a hiring process, being involved in merger and acquisition process, protection of intellectual property, etc. As a corporate affairs minister in the Union government, I happen to author this new company law after 6 or 7 national consultations in the country. One of the primary aims of competition is to diffuse socio-economic power of the incumbents and broaden the economic and social base by encouraging participation of new entrants and thus fostering innovation and growth. It improves consumer welfare by stirring up inter-firm rivalry that compels each firm to excel to satisfy the consumer by offering better deals and newer products with superior quality of low prices. The principal objective of competition law is to foster competition as an instrument for accelerating growth through innovation and economic efficiencies, thus maximizing consumer welfare by offering better products at lower prices. It achieves this objective in 3 ways. 1, prohibiting anti-competition agreements and practices that harm free trade and competition. 2, preventing abuse of dominance and anti-competitive practices that lead to such a dominant position. 3, regulating mergers acquisition. Competition law is essentially an economic law. It is anathema to the purists and doctrinaire. Owen Dixon, Chief Justice of Australia, when asked whether it was part of the duty of a lawyer to contribute towards the progress of society, replied it was not. The duty of a lawyer, he said, was, I quote, to keep a hand on and hold steady the framework and foundation of law. We have come a long way since U.S. Supreme Court Judge Justice Brandeis, the author of the famous Brandeis brief that has motivated social and economic legislation in U.S. says, I quote, a lawyer who has not studied economics is very apt to become a public enemy, unquote. Maybe some of you can differ it, but this is not my quote. These are harsh words, but as Lord Keynes said, I quote, words have sometimes to be harsh, seen as they represent an assault on the thought of the unthinking. unquote. An overriding aim of competition law is to promote economic justice. It is a handmaiden of modern economies and should be part of laws that reflect societal values known as sociological jurisprudence, says our own senior advocate Falim Nariman, one of India's foremost jurists. Nonetheless, this concept of economic law anathema to the purists and doctrinaires. Again, I repeat, in effect, its effective implementation would require a cultural change and change in the mindset of legal producers. Because we have to go a long way to ensure that this culture is developed. The legal fraternity and juries are formidable challenge to use law as a driver of change, innovation and inclusive growth. This would mean bring goodbye to the groupthink and capitalizing the 5 Ds, disruption of status quo and valuing diversity, dissent, dialogue and disclosure. Lawyers are tied to a noble tradition of inventiveness. The most ennobling element of lawyer's profession is that it can ensure justice for his client. Justice is the only weapon that can secure stability to society and provide sustainability to business. As Pope Paul VI said, if you want peace, work for justice. This is the basics. So I'm quite happy that, you know, today to associate with this global conference, which is hosted by Symbiosis, particularly Dr. Mujumdar. And really happy to associate with, our Sri Jet Melani, who is a Mahaguru of law. Thank you very much. All the best.
Thank you very much, sir, for that very erudite address to the gathering. Advocate Ram Jethmalani, Professor Emeritus, Symbiosis International University. He's a member of the Rajya Sabha and has been the former Law Minister of India and former Chairman of the Bar Council of India. He is well known for making representations in landmark cases that brought new facets to legal interpretation in India, and is a senior advocate at the Supreme Court Bar. I now welcome our chief guest, Advocate Ram Jethmalani, to address the gathering.
My friends on the stage and off the stage, of both sexes and of all ages, I will not waste time and calling attention to the presence of these distinguished persons both on the stage and off the stage. Because if you see the program of today, it doesn't ask me to speak on any subject, but it only says that you have 15 minutes. Well, I'll put up with that, but that also requires some kind of accommodation from you. I'm not concerned so much with what has been talked about by my great predecessor, who of course paid a tribute to me, but I must say that today the most important thing to deal with is the misuse of religion and the misuse of the character of politicians. These are two things which require tremendous attention and require a lot of social interest and study. First of all, let me tell you that I am a great, great admirer of the religion of Islam. Though I am not a Muslim, I am a Hindu, but I belong to Sindh, where Hindus and Muslims lived in peace all the time, and never did a single riot or anything of that kind take place. But my friends, there is a book which you all must read if you have not read it before. The title of the book is Religion Gone Astray. It's a book which is not written by one person. It is written by three persons. One is a Jewish rabbi. The second is a Christian pastor. And the third is a Muslim imam. Though that book is not written by any Indian, not even a contributor to that book is an Indian, and yet you will find, if you take charge of that book and open it, that the book is dedicated to Mahatma Gandhi. Well, read that book and you will find today that religion is one of the things which is a cause of tremendous trouble, at least in our part of the world. I don't know in other parts from where our foreign guests have arrived. But my friends, every religion has a core and an essence. But every religion has at the same time a lot of disposable stuff. You might call it some completely dispensable stuff, and sometimes it is almost a disgrace to have that a part of the religion. But human intellect must apply itself to the determination of the essence of every religion. And I am the greatest admirer of the Prophet of Islam, because the Prophet of Islam himself gave the essence of Islam to consist of two lines. I wonder if anybody can tell me what those two lines are. I am afraid you will not, even those who come from Muslim countries. My friends, there are only two lines which constitute the essence of the whole of Quran. The first is that when you walk in search of knowledge, you are walking in the path of God. The second is even more important than the first. The second is that the ink of the scholar is holier than the blood of a martyr. And my friends, when this was the understanding of the Quran Sharif by the Muslims, they rose to the highest levels of conquest of the world. Muslims conquered even Spain. And I remember that in one city in ancient part of the world, there was a great scholar living there. He was invited by the Khalifa to go and live in the palace of the Khalifa. Very politely he refused. He said, "Sir, please don't ask me to come and live in your palace. I know that you gave me a lot of pleasure and happiness and so on, but I don't want to come." So the Khalifa insisted, and this man persisted in his refusal, and finally he told him, "Sir, let me tell you the reason why I don't want to come. If I shift my residence today, I require at least 400 camels to transport my library." That was the highest point in the growth of Islam, and no wonder that Islam conquered almost every part of the civilized world that existed in that time. It's in the 13th century that the Muslims suffered the greatest tragedy in the life of Islam. Then the Khalifa addressed them and told them that burn all books except the Quran. And after that, they became the slaves of those whom they had conquered before. And ultimately, the slavery still is paramount today, and that is a paramount feature of Muslim life. So my friends, today we are in a great, great trouble. The trouble is that a counterfeit version of Islam is troubling this world. And that is not to be called Islam, but it is, according to me, the proper name of that new religion is Wahhabism. Wahhab was a late 17th century or an early 18th century person born in Saudi Arabia. And he had a very strange philosophy. His philosophy was in one line that all mushrikun have forfeited their right to live. And the definition of mushrikun was Jews, Christians, Hindus, Buddhists, everybody, including the Shias. And today you find that the Shias are being literally killed in Pakistan and in other parts of the Islamic world. And today, the IS and the IS in particular are instruments which are out to destroy even the Shias, who are very, very, very happy that there is at least one Shia country which has risen to political power, and that is Iran. And Iran today is protecting the Shias. So my friends, at least in India, today even the Shias are absolutely safe, and we do not subscribe to this Wahhabi philosophy. And that is why today, at least India is safe, and India will remain safe so long as we do not succumb to this counterfeit Islam that is called Wahhabism, according to me. And my friends, today, the biggest error that has taken place in this world is that we have a great, great problem, and that problem is the exact connotation of what has got to be done today so far as the rest of our problems of the world are concerned. And my friends, today we have to see to it, that religion is put in a proper shell and is under a proper control. And how now do you turn to the character of our politicians? The character of politicians is of the greatest importance today. And I'm afraid that something has got to be done about that character, which is very, very unfortunately lacking. Now I can tell you that today, politicians are doubtless in power. They are enjoying power, and even politicians share the stage with me. But my friends, the politicians of today are not people which have the requisite kind of character. And that character has got to be built, and that character can only be built if you keep a very, very close watch upon their movements. And my friends, how do you deal with this particular problem of the character of our politicians? Now the character of our politicians will be taken care of by an honest and a vigorously honest judiciary. And I assure you that when the present Chief Justice, whom you heard on the television today, we welcomed him at the bar, and I was sitting in the front line in the crowded hall in which the meeting was taking place, and suddenly the chairman of the Bar Council spotted my presence from the stage, and he saw me and he said, "Mr. Jethmalani is here, so let him say a few words about the Chief Justice." I paid my glorious tribute to this Chief Justice, whom I like. He is a great Chief Justice. But after I had paid my tribute to him, I did tell him that, "Sir, I must tell you that I will not have the pleasure of appearing before you because I have decided to renounce practice and I shall not appear any longer in courts, but I intend to perform another role now, and that role which I am performing today is the role of dealing with corrupt politicians who somehow are disgracing this world. And I assure you that it's a very, very serious problem. And I have written out a whole pamphlet consisting of a notice which I have personally served on whom? On the present Prime Minister of India and some of his colleagues in the cabinet, because they have completely let down the nation. I must tell you that the German government paid a bribe of $475 million to an employee of the Liechtenstein Bank, and that employee gave the names of 1,400 rascals who had accounts in the Liechtenstein Bank. And when the list was examined by the German government announced that in this list of 1,400 rascals, the majority of the names are unfortunately of Indians. And my friends, the German government made an announcement that India is a friendly country, and being a friendly country, we are prepared to give this information to the Indian government, provided they ask for it. And my friends, I had already gone to the Supreme Court because the German offer had not been availed of either by the ruling Congress party at that time or by the opposition BJP party at that time. And in fact, the Congress party, which were appearing as defendants in my suit in the Supreme Court of India, they made a false affidavit and said that we have approached the Germans and the Germans have not given us any information about these rascals in the Liechtenstein Bank. I went to Germany, my friends. I went to Germany and I talked to the Germans, and I was in the company of a big German lawyer who was an old friend of mine. And I talked to the German government and said that, "Please understand one thing, that India is a democracy. You have obligations to the people of India and not to the government of India, because I am here a member of the opposition and I have come to tell you that the government of India itself is corrupt and they are involved in this dealing." My friends, the German government told me that, "Mr. Jethmalani, you are right. Kindly go back to India and ask two or three opposition leaders to write letters to us that the people of India want this information about corrupt people in India, and we'll certainly give it to you, and also tell them to write that Mr. Jethmalani is looking for this information on behalf of the people of India." My friends, I came back and I gave even a small letter written out in 6 lines and handed it over to 3 important politicians of the BJP. The politicians of the BJP I will name to you. One I selected, a Sindhi gentleman, Mr. L.K. Advani, whom I have defended in an old money laundering case up to the Supreme Court, got him out. And my friends, Balbir Pund, a third was another, Murli Manohar Joshi. After a week, I asked them, I said, where is that letter which the Germans are waiting for to give us information? They said, we forgot. I said, how can 3 persons forget the same important thing at the same time? And I said, now forget it. You are lying, but I will accept your lie. Today is the 8th day. Now kindly sign the letter today and send it to me. The letter has never come till today. 2 years have gone by. And my friends, in July 2000, I have a deadline of 15 minutes. I hope I have not exceeded it already, but I will probably exceed it by 2 or 3 minutes. What happened was that then I asked the Supreme Court, to release that kind of correspondence and give us all the papers by which it is said that they had approached the Germans and the Germans have not given them information. The Supreme Court had fixed the delivery of that judgment in July 2011 after the vacation, and my friends, everybody knew that the thumping judgment is coming from the Supreme Court in favor of Ram Jethmalani and his colleagues. And what did they do? And I am talking of another crook called Manmohan Singh. He called the Swiss finance minister, entered into a secret protocol